My name is Christine May. I will be your service leader today. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Bay County. You are welcome here, whether you are young or old, no matter your skin color or your physical abilities, whomever you love, no matter your age, regardless of income, you are welcome here this morning in this religious home. Our opening words are from Reverend Sarah C. Stewart, "To Remember Our Promises." Bring who you are as you enter our church this morning. Bring your best self and your struggling self. Bring your mistakes and your triumphs. Bring your shortcomings and your recommitment to good. Bring yourself here and open your heart to beauty, to truth, to the door that is open to the presence of God. Here in this church, we are trying to walk together on a peaceable way, trying to hammer out division and hatred and all that separates one from another. We try and we will fall short, but held in love, we try again. We come together this morning as a church to bow our heads in prayer, to raise our voices in song, to remember our promises and vow to live by them once again. And Matt is going to light on the chalice while I read our covenant. Please join me. A little technical close. Love is the spirit of this fellowship, and service is its way. This is our covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, to promote a sustainable world, and to help one another. Our hymn today is number 318, We Would Be One.
Thanks, Matt. I love singing with you. We now have a time for all ages that you're going to laugh at me, but it makes me so happy. I found it a while ago, and I've been looking for something that could use it. This works today, I think. You tell me what you think, Lear. It's called Tiny the God by Becky Brooks. Once upon a time, there was a tiny, little, itty-bitty, very small, tiny little god named Tiny. She lived her life hearing stories of all the big gods, and well, let's face it, she was jealous. She knew she needed to think of some kind of special spark of an idea that would make her existence meaningful. After watching humans for a long time, she hit upon something that just might work. Something to make people think, yeah, that Tiny has a really good idea going. This was it. This was going to make her famous. Are you ready? Here it is. You are not alone. She took the form of a very light breeze, and in a voice so quiet, each person heard it only in their mind, she said, you are not alone. You are not alone. People loved it. It was perfect because who doesn't want to hear that? Pretty soon, Tiny was comforting people all over with, you are not alone. Every evening, she took the form of the breeze and whispered it in people's minds. Until one day, she encountered someone who wasn't comforted at all. When Miriam heard Tiny's words in her mind, instead of feeling comforted, she felt agitated. Something was just kind of off about it. She kept saying it to herself over and over. You are not alone. You are not alone. She tossed and turned. She couldn't sleep. In the morning, she went to read the paper instead of skimming everything. She found herself dreaming in every single story. She was only halfway through when she found herself crying. I am not alone, she said. I am connected to every one of these people. They live in my town and my country and my world. They love their children like I love mine. They're scared sometimes, and so am I. They hurt like I hurt. I am not alone. I can help. Tiny was surprised. It hadn't occurred to her that someone might think about it that way. Tiny kept watch over Miriam to monitor this interesting development. Miriam and a co-worker met online in a meeting to talk about a law they hoped the Senate would pass. And Tiny noticed when Miriam wrote a letter to her senator right away. She noticed that when Miriam turned in her grocery order, she brought a few extra things for her neighbor and left them with a colorful note on their porch. She noticed that Miriam had tears in her eyes when she joined in her congregation's worship on her computer, and she heard her favorite hymn through the small speakers. Miriam got out her phone and made an extra donation to her congregation. She watched as Miriam wrote postcards to her friends and family near and far, waved to the dog walkers who passed her house, and strung up colorful lights in the living room window. But most importantly for Tiny, she noticed when Miriam received a phone call one evening from a friend she hadn't heard from in a long while. His voice was shaking. I'm having a hard time, he said. He started to tell her about his problems, but he began to cry. Miriam got herself comfortable in her favorite chair. Take your time. I'll stay on the line with you. You are not alone. I am here. I am here. Tiny heard those words like an echo in her mind. You are not alone. I am here. You are not alone. I am here. In that moment, Tiny knew that she was nothing without Miriam's hands and heart and spirit. And she knew that what she wanted, what the world needed more than anything, was what Miriam had learned to give. So Tiny went to work. Instead of just spending her evening spreading the gospel about you are not alone, she spent her nighttimes doing it too, and her mornings and the afternoons. Pretty soon, she was spending every moment doing it until she became
the breeze itself. And that is why there are no paintings of Tiny, no busts or holy books, just a breeze, a low voice, and many, many helping hands, loving hearts, and caring spirits. You can hear the echo if you listen closely. You are not alone. I am here. When water bottles are left in the desert for those who risk their lives to cross it, you are not alone. I am here. At the bedside of a dying man, you are not alone. I am here. In the jailhouse and sanctuary, you are not alone. I am here. Separate and together, you are not alone. I am here. May it be so. The story is published in Sparks of Wonder by Peggy Brooks and Erica Heumann.
Announcements.
Well, I don't really have any announcements that were sent to me this week, so I thought I would take this time to say happy Passover, wishing you love, peace, togetherness, health, joy, and happiness today and always to our Jewish friends and those who celebrate Passover. Joys and concerns. Again, I don't have anything anyone has said, but if you have something you would like to share, please put it in the chat, either on Facebook or in the Zoom, and we will think and love along with you. I would like to say one thing, which is that a dear friend of mine is holding time and love and peace as his father goes to the hospice care. So I would like to have you send some thoughts and love to keep going. Ours is a welcoming community where we find connection, a spiritual community where we find meaning. Ours is a sharing community where our joys are amplified, a caring community where our sorrows are lessened. We take this moment to reflect on our joys and sorrows and acknowledge the mutual support of our community. We take a moment of silence, and then Ron will play, and Matt will sing Spirit of Life, number 123.
We would normally take an offering to allow us to exercise that all-important generosity of spirit
an offering to support this self-supporting church and its ministries. Please remember to send in your pledges, and thank you for your generosity. Our reading is from the Soul Matters resource. As always, when I'm service leader, I find the words that I need to hear. I hope you appreciate them too. This is The Moments of My High Resolve from the Reverend Howard Thurman, The Inward Journey. Keep fresh before me the moments of my high resolve. Despite the dullness and barrenness of the days that pass, if I search with due diligence, I can always find a deposit left me, left by some former reads. But I have forgotten. At the time it was full orbed, glorious, and resplendent, I was sure that I would never forget. In the moment of its fullness, I was sure it would illumine my path for the rest of my journey. I had forgotten how easy it is to forget. There was no intent to betray what seemed so sure at the time. My response was whole, clean, and authentic. But little by little, there crept into my life the dust and grit of the journey. Details, lower level demands, all kinds of crosscurrents. Nothing momentous, nothing overwhelming, nothing flagrant, just wear and tear. If there had been some direct challenge, a clear-cut issue, I would have fought it to the end and beyond. In the quietness of this time, surrounded by the all-pervading presence of God, my heart whispers, keep fresh before me the moments of my high resolve, that in fair weather or in foul, in good times or in tempests, in the days when the darkness and the foe are nameless or familiar, I may not forget that to which my life is committed. Keep fresh before me the moments of my high resolve. The speaker today is Reverend Kenneth Gordon Perto. He is a graduate of Augustana College in Long Island, Illinois, and of the Divinity School at Harvard University. For 45 years as an active parish minister until his retirement in 2017, he served Unitarian Universalist congregations, small and large, in Indiana, Iowa, Virginia, Florida, New Zealand, and Australia. Ken concluded his ministry while serving for 12 years as member and lead of the UUA Southern Region staff. Throughout his ministry, Ken has been sought out for his expertise in Roman family systems theory as applies to congregational life. His particular interests, including mission and vision work, nurturing accountable leadership, results-based stewardship, and managing congregational conflict. Ken is a self-described mystical religious humanist. He celebrates a ministry of living in love with respect for human dignity and courage for justice. He lives in Vero Beach with his wife, Jeannie Kelly, and St. Abbot, scuba diver, cyclist, and novice gardener. I met Ken during his time at the UUA on the staff. Strongest memories of him are the impromptu chapel service on September 11th, 2001. We were both there. It was a powerful time. Thank you, Ken, for being here with us. It's your turn.
Thank you, Chris. Good to see you again. And thank you, good folks there in Bay County, for keeping the light of the Free Church shining brightly. Hard work to do ministry in these times and to do it creatively and cope with the limitations of this wonderfully helpful technology called Zoom and Facebook streaming. You're doing good work, so keep it up. I've chosen a weird title for you this morning, an archaic utilization of the phrase common weal. it's related to Commonwealth, but I wanted the broader notion of the notion of weal or health. And to ask the question, is there a common good that makes us healthy? Is there a shared sense of what it means to care for the public welfare? This is inspired in part by the genuinely heartbroken expressions in recent months of folks who would say, this is not who we are, in reaction to some kind of violent, disturbing event. This is not who we are led me to ask, well, who are we? What does it mean to be an American? And I couldn't help but remember that moment when Sarah Palin some years ago went to South Carolina and rejoiced that she finally was in a group of real Americans, by which she meant mostly white men or people who are already in positions of power and privilege in our society. Who is a real American? And then, you know, I was kind of hopeful with the election results and the words coming from now President Biden that maybe we could return to having that conversation about the common good, the public welfare. I was kind of hopeful. And then January 6th happened. And I saw people carrying the American flag and even using it as a weapon. And I said, who is a real American? Because those folks who were storming the sacred temple of democracy, trying to disrupt its process, saw themselves as patriots. What sense are we to make of this? Well, I was hopeful, I remain hopeful that we can perhaps move beyond the divisions of this bipolar culture of ours to find some unity, some shared values, some shared concern for the good of us all, instead of one battling group after another. I remain hopeful that the phrase American would include all our people, rich and poor, East Coast, West Coast, rural, urban, and so forth. That to be an American is simply to live here and care for its well-being as a common good. So let me ask you then, what would it be to have a common good? Are there a set of values and practices that hold us together, that give meaning to the phrase, the United States of America? Well, something wicked this way has come. More and more, our social dialogue is a matter of competition, not only for goods and services, but for power and to prevail in any of our disagreements about policy. More and more, our social discourse has become a high-stakes battle, not even a game, high-stakes battle, in which winners take it all and the losers be damned. Tragically, there are some who are willing not only to die for their understanding of what it means to be an American, they're willing to kill for it as well. Something wicked this way has come. A commonwealth is premised on the idea that there is a public good and that the public good merits our attention and our embrace and our loyalty and our willingness to work to create common good, not just particular good. Jefferson once wrote that the United States came together to form a more perfect union, and we are far from being perfect, that's for sure. In addition to the you and the me, there should also be a sense of us. And how do we do that? Now, people of faith over time everywhere have said that we're all God's children, whatever language and dialect they said, that we're all part of a divine structure. And all our differences are minuscule compared to what we have in common. Embedded in that is a theology about a political idea. It is the foundation of democracy, that every voice matters, every person matters, and that we embody our conversations around the common good through this process called voting. Well, we're certainly seeing that a lot of people right now don't want everyone to have their voice. They're doing their best to limit those who can actually speak, be heard. It's hard to have a conversation about the common good if you're deliberately keeping people out of that conversation. We as Unitarian Universalists affirm and seek to promote democracy, to promote a universal ethic, the notion that we're all God's children and all are worthy of being loved and practicing love. For Unitarian Universalists, the we matters as much as the me. Sadly, those, our whole society is anything but universalistic in its embrace. Theologically, if you know your theology, Calvinism is what drives our country. It's the notion that there are two kinds of people, the saved and the damned. And how do you know you're saved? It's because you've got the power over others in society. And how do you know you're damned? Is you can't get to first base in a baseball game. It is a lack of a shared sense of the common good that leaves our society so bitterly divided. With a generous reading of our history, one can say that there has been a gradual expansion of who's included in the us of America, but we're a long way from being comfortable with it, meaning everyone. Now, I'm going to ask you to do something as I continue here in the chat box or on the Facebook streaming. Could you list succinctly, one or two words only, what you think are quintessential values or practices or ideals that define what it means to be an American? I'm going to try to do it myself here over the next few minutes. If I were to make a list of American values that I think are part of the common good, I would begin with the U.S. Constitution, in which Jefferson wrote, "We are gathered to pursue, to ensure the life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness for all." Now, I should note that when he first wrote it, it was the right to property, but good news, he got pushed aside for happiness. If we go from there to the amendments to the Constitution, because it was not yet a perfect union, we find there are amendments for freedom. Freedom of worship, freedom of the press, the right to bear arms, right to assemble peaceably, to petition the government, and to fair and speedy trials. Those are our rights, our common good. Next are the amendments to fairness, equality of opportunity, is an important core value. Fair treatment is an important core value. We are offended when either of those is constrained or removed. Then there are what I call amendments of inclusion, the abolition of slavery, the granting of suffrage to women, expanding definitions of citizenship as found in the 14th Amendment. Less formally, there are the issues of culture as well as law. Oh, before going on, I should say, one of the things that makes the American common good different is that we are a nation of laws, not of men. That ideal, that understanding has been sorely tried in the last handful of years, but we are still a nation of laws. Additional American values broadly shared include individualism and self-reliance, a sense that your personal self, your privacy is treasure, to be treasured. Your autonomy as a free agent is to be honored. That not only are we talking about self-governance for a nation, we're talking about self-governance of ourselves, that we are responsible for our behaviors. Generally, we value pragmatism, get it done. We like practicality and efficiency. for the longest while, we've relied mostly on science and technology and the idea that truth is has its foundation in evidence. For the most part, that has been our core value. We've seen that attacked in the last several years as well. Americans are an officially optimistic society. We embrace the notion of possibility and change. We have a sense that tomorrow can yet be better. That's the great hopefulness of our society, that this is not the final chapter. There is more goodness to be had. We value directness. We find it rather arcane to listen to other cultures where they never say exactly what they mean. You have to know the inside code language. We value openness, frankness, honesty, especially. Maybe that's why it's been so heartbreaking this last several years to have the nation's leader lie and lie and lie and lie and yet again lie. That's intolerable. We value volunteerism. As de Tocqueville noted, that was one of our unique traits. And frankly, we like being rather informal rather than stuffy about wearing wigs and things like that. But what would you take? What would you add to this notion of the core sense of being an American? Give me a pause here. I want to see if any of you added something different in the chat here while I was. Self-sufficiency, equality, right to vote, equity and justice, freedom and fairness, representation versus dictatorship, abide by laws and freedom. Thank you for that. I appreciate that, those contributions. Well, with optimism and a belief in possibility, we find our common ground sometimes in the legacy of our heritage and its failures, in the ways our espoused values are out of sync with our practice. For example, it took a horrific civil war, killing almost 700,000 Americans, pitting brother against brother, to repudiate the constitutional compromise that defined Blacks as 3/5 of a human being and that they could be owned as property by others. That was over 150 years ago. And yet the struggle for fair treatment and respect for people of color continues. Our nation's original sin, slavery, was abolished with the 13th Amendment in 1865. And yet the entrenched practices of that sin remain with us still and color our sense of what it means to be a free society. The phrase white supremacy has entered most of our vocabularies these days. It has challenged us to deal with the codified, entrenched practices and injustices that limit healthcare, employment, education, home ownership, and how our police and laws, how our laws are policed and enforced. There's great discrepancies when it comes to how all of that applies to people of color. Women, thanks to Unitarian Universalists like Susan B. Anthony, obtained the suffrage, the franchise to vote, with the 19th Amendment just 100 or so years ago. While progress has been made, let's say it bluntly, the glass ceiling is real. Women are still paid significantly less than men. The Equal Rights Amendment has languished unratified since 1972, and just 10 days ago, the Congress adopted House Bill 1620, the Violence Against Women Act, the Violence Against Women Act reauthorization of 1921. Over 170 members of the House, most of them Republican, voted against it. It's as though they were saying violence against women is something that's okay. How can it be? How can our sense of the common good be so shrunk that there would be even any debate for the need to have this authorization. Clearly, we don't value the equality of men and women any more than we do blacks and whites. And briefly, though there's been fair treatment of employees, of workers, and had improved up through the Reagan era, and has since been contracting to creating an increasing gap of wealth between wage earners and the owners of capital. The days of Irish need not apply may be long behind us, but blacks, Asians, indigenous Americans, Latinos, often is the case they need not apply, should not apply, and if we can have our way, cannot apply. Our espoused value, sadly, is often at odds with our reality. Now, I don't want to belabor the obvious. Historically and yet today, American people have been adroit at creating outgroups, having someone to despise, to dislike, to ensure they don't get to participate as real Americans. How can you have a common good if that's at work in society? Where you say some people just don't merit their citizenship, their integrity. Central to the American ethos is radical individualism. I get to do my thing, you do your thing, and so forth. But you're not the boss of me has become a form of idolatry by which I can escape being responsible to you and to others. I can do my thing and the hell with you. The me becomes more important than the we. No common good there. It's just me against you and you against me. Part of the polarization of our society is when folks cluster around an issue and turn it into a win-lose proposition. Take gun control, for example. We know the majority of Americans want something to be done finally about guns, and I'm going to put money on this one. Nothing's going to happen after the recent tragedies in Atlanta and Boulder. Call me a cynic. Anyway, a lot of issues along that line. But it's been the people of faith of which we are among that said the we matters. Rabbi Hillel, the teacher of Jesus, once asked, if I am not for myself, who will be for me? If I am not for others, what am I? And if not now, when? I'm suggesting to you as a people of faith, now is the time. And it is spiritual work for me and for you and anyone we encounter to work to create a common good. It is soul work. It is spiritually a matter of life and death. If we do not work for inclusion, if we simply embrace the Calvinist notion that some are preferred and some are not, we will descend into a war of each against all. It will be hell on earth. It's not just true for you and me and our interactions with others. This is a worldwide question. We still see this sense in which people pivot every issue into, I got to win and you got to lose. So I'm challenging you, challenging me to become more adroit about being present to one another in our difference. Can we look for the common ground in all our encounters, especially those that are difficult and dense? The phrase, let us find ways to disagree without becoming disagreeable, has been an important part of my ministry because I've seen churches go into this kind of win-lose, either or, my way or the highway kind of thinking. Our faith encourages, indeed expects us to do the work to learn to be respectful of one another. We are not a faith tradition of orthodoxy, although we have our own orthodoxies by which we exclude those who do not subscribe to the dominant humanist ethos among us. It is soul work for us to resist cloning one another emotionally, intellectually, spiritually, morally. Because we're unique, we are individuals with our own stuff, it behooves us to become good at working through being present to our differences without becoming mean-spirited and disagreeable. Now, as a preacher, I think I always see it as my job to give you something to think about or to work on in the days ahead. So I want to move to sort of the teachable moment of our conversation this morning. Conflict is part of the human condition, and we are currently paralyzed by some of our conflicts. I've learned that there's three basic kinds of conflicts, and I think you'll recognize this. The first is resource allocation. Every church budget meeting deals with that. There's issues of pay equity. How do we divide the income and the expense of life? How do we allow access or prohibition to goods and services? How do we allot the benefits of society across the board? Right now, there's a debate here in Florida, at least, that once again, the rich are getting the vaccine and the poor, well, maybe one of these days. There's something painful about that. Most conflicts of resource allocation can be negotiated, can be worked through, if at least with people of goodwill. They don't have to agree on everything, but they can, yeah. Politics is the art of compromise, as it was once said. The second kind of conflict, more difficult, is that of values. In addition to deciding how limited resources will be allocated, our values conflicts deal with why they should be allocated, however they are going to be. Values include our sense of right and proper behavior, our notion of why resources are to be allocated, and what we deem to be the moral good. Values conflicts, as I said, are more difficult because we may not even agree on what a standard or rule is to be applied in adjudicating our differences. We certainly see this in the realm of religious life. As Unitarian Universalists, I'm sure you run into Christian folk who just want to damn you to hell and have nothing to do with you because we don't share their premise about the Bible. Another instance, if you're a woman and you're told that your value is to be a homemaker above all, then those around you will care little about equal pay distribution. Or if you're a woman valuing autonomy and agency, limiting her access to education or work is a violation of her integrity. And there are those for whom that's unimportant. Or sometimes our own values don't mesh. I don't know about you, but sometimes I'm an internal box of contradictions. For example, if you believe that life is sacred, which I do, then not only must you at some level risk abortion, you won't support assisted suicide for your ailing and suffering grandfather. More, you'll want to put an end to the death penalty as consistent with being pro-life. You're going to do your darndest to work for the cessation of war, which is a violation of human life. And working all that out can put you into some real internal conflict. As an erstwhile president of Planned Parenthood early in my ministry, I really struggled with those for whom life meant so little, that they thought getting an abortion was just a matter of making a phone call. I wanted to be compassionate, and yet there was something terribly difficult in having those conversations. Sometimes our life experiences put us in conflict. I don't make sense to you. You don't make sense to me. Perhaps, like most Americans, you value punctuality and efficiency. And what do you do? How do you interact with someone who comes from an indigenous tribe somewhere in the world, or maybe here in the United States, for whom clock time is not the most important way to monitor how we regulate our lives? If you're a supervisor and an employee comes to work when they say the time is right, you've got problems. So our differing experiences can lead to a clash of values. And that's why it's so hard to prize both diversity and commonality. It feels like they're often at odds. Lastly, consider there are many whose notion of being human requires that they conform to absolute rules of right and wrong. often I regret, promulgated by religious teachers. Many of our social conflicts stem from rule-driven people who cannot abide the, well, it depends of people like me. Liberals are fearful of judgmentalism that's implicit in these rule behaviors. We think that there are some things you don't know for certain what to do. For me, context and complexity matter, and rules rarely cover every possible situation in our changing culture. Take medical ethics. How do our old rules answer questions about the morality of cloning or using aborted stem cells to create antiviral drugs? Interestingly enough, one of which was used on the former president. As a teacher, I say intellectual and spiritual maturity requires cultivating a growing tolerance for ambiguity, not an embracing of absolutarianism. The rule-driven folks have no patience with people like me. Now, thirdly, and this is the one that you're going to see everywhere after this week, identity conflict, where people's sense of who they are as a human being is wrapped up in some social policy or practice. Good way to understand that is this little ditty called Die Heretic. Once I saw a guy on a bridge about to jump, and I said, "Don't do it." He said, "Nobody loves me." And I said, "Well, God loves you. Do you believe in God?" And the man said, "Yes." "So am I," I said. "Are you a Christian or a Jew?" And he said, "A Christian." "Well, me too. Protestant or Catholic?" He said, "Protestant." "Well, me too." "What franchise?" He said, "Baptist." "Me too. Northern Baptist or Southern Baptist?" He asked. I asked. He said, "Northern Baptist." "Well, now I'm overjoyed. Northern Baptist, me too. Conservative Baptist or Northern Liberal Baptist?" He said, "Northern Conservative Baptist." "Me too. Northern Conservative Baptist, Great Lakes region, or Northern Conservative Baptist, Eastern region?" He said, "Northern Conservative Baptist, Great Lakes region." Oh, my relief. "Me too." And then I asked, "Northern Conservative Baptist Council, Great Lakes region of 1879, or Northern Conservative Baptist, Great Lakes region Council of 1912? He said, "Council of 1912. I said, "Die, heretic," and I pushed him off the bridge. Resource and values conflicts are of that ilk. We just keep going narrower and narrower into our definition of what's right and what's wrong and who's good and who's bad. And we end up into battles of personal survival, life and death. You know, take, for example, the issue of where Blacks sat on buses many years ago. It wasn't a resource allocation issue of who's, do we have enough seats and all that. It was white people saying that they had the privilege of sitting up front, and how dare a Black woman take away their privilege. It threatened their sense of who they were. And indeed, much of the civil rights effort of the last century has been dealing with white folks feeling entitled, like they own the franchise on being human. And how dare those uppity Blacks tell us otherwise? Identity conflicts arise from a limited, often adversarial notion of human community. Tragically, identity-based conflicts are everywhere, and they lead to genocidal violence, such as was seen in Rwanda, or in human rights abuses, such as we're seeing in the treatment of girls in Nairobi. The reason such conflicts become so intense is that it feels as though your very sense of being alive is at risk if they're not affirmed. If the flag you wave, the clothes you wear, the dialect you speak are threatening to my sense of health, well, then I'm going to feel I have every reason to do away with you, make you change, conform to me, or I destroy you. This is why some conflicts are so intractable, such as Northern Ireland, the Palestine, Miramar, and the US Congress. This is part of what the January insurrection revealed most about us, I fear. It wasn't just about the former president's delusion about election outcomes. It was about his inability and his followers' inability to see him as a loser. His followers seduced themselves by identifying with the equation that only if they won was the election fair, and that they did not means it was rigged, straight out of the president's mouth. I tell you, there's no reasoning with people in such a mental state. Our vaunted affirmation about reason and religion is worthless in these circumstances. While resource conflicts can be intense, a source of frustration, values conflicts can be contentious and difficult to establish a common set of values. Identity conflicts are much more difficult because they're matters of life and death. It's a very short step from raising your voice to drowning out those of others, to wielding a cudgel to shut them up. So the lesson for our conversation today is that you will be no more effective trying to reason with somebody who feels emotionally cornered, feels their survival is at risk, and they're ready to fight and win or die losing, than yelling calm down to a child throwing a temper tantrum in the grocery store. I say if you can, stay away from such encounters. And if you can't, run as fast as you can. And if you cannot run, be prepared to take a stand that may cost yours or another's life. None of this, in my judgment, is the American way. Sadly, it is all too important part of the human way. So, is there a common good? I'm sorry, I don't think so. I don't know if ever there was. And I think you will find in the roster of American values we've gone through, there are many who don't hold them. And yet they can be something for us to hold on to and to be inspired by. Theodore Parker, Unitarian preacher, 1841, said, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice, and our history can be seen that way." But oh my God, how slowly, how terribly, terribly slowly it bends. If we are to be true to our Unitarian Universalists, we must commit to living in all ways, always, to be loving, to be respectful, to be committed to the truth, freedom, and to work for justice. Years ago, Edwin Markham wrote a poem that I leave you with. "He drew a circle that shut me out, heretic, rebel, and a thing to flout. But love and I had the wit to win, where he drew a circle and took him in." Be good at embracing those around you. All love to you. Peace. Namaste.
Thank you, Ken. That was powerful and wonderful. Matt is going to extinguish the chalice while I read the closing words from Kimberly Quinn Johnson. "We are the ones we have been waiting for. We are not perfect, but we are perfectly fitted for this day. We are not without fault, but we can be honest to face our past as we charge a new future. We are the ones we've been waiting for. May we be bold and courageous to chart that new future. May we have faith in a future that is not known. We are the ones we've been waiting for." Ron will play and Matt will sing, "Though Lifted Up," for us to close this service. It is hymn number 1057 in the Teal Hymnal. And we will continue to meet on Zoom, and Ken has agreed to stay with us to answer questions and chat.